Check, I think it's time to start. Good afternoon all. Did you guys enjoy your lunch? No? That's a bummer.
Oh, we did.
We did. It was okay. Welcome to our session. We're going to talk about performance. And actually, we got a lot of content for you. Therefore, we have a slight warning for you all. It's going to be an information overload. So we're not responsible for any side effects. So you're sitting at your own risk. Please beware of that. So let's start with an introduction. My name is Ryan Verwis-Bijkerk. I'm a consultant at ICT Partners, which is a small consulting company within the Netherlands, where I'm responsible for implementations of workspaces. I have a primary focus on performance, so I do a lot of performance testing also at my customers and resolving issues. I'm quite active within the community. I got a V-Expert, and since this year also the Technology Advocate Award, so I'm very happy with that. I blog a lot.
And my name is Eltje Vergulik. You might recognize me. I'm the Hemsen guy on the right. I also work for the same company as Ryan. I've also been awarded the CTA award this year, which I'm very proud of. I'm not as involved in the community as Ryan is, but I do hold a lot more CERTIC certifications, but somehow we decided not to put those on.
Sorry, Eltje. So I've got a quick question for you all. How many of you know ICTR by raising your hands? Okay, quite a few.
I've got more than five.
Yeah, I'm quite impressed. ICTR is our community platform. And what we do there is we research interesting topics within the EUC space. We just started it. We started since September 2018. And we are community-based and fully independent and unbiased. So we take different products out and research those and write a lot of interesting stuff about them. Since September, we already run over 1,200 tests, and this is actually not that accurate because it's more. Our lab environment is running almost 24/7, continuously after each other. The platform is community-based. It is, though, powered by our company right now. Servers cost money, so we have to pay those. So ICT Partners is a proud sponsor of this initiative. But we want to use this opportunity at Synergy to actually introduce our rebranding. Because we really want to be community-focused, we decided to go with a new name instead of ICTR. So in the upcoming weeks, we're going to redesign everything to go EUC as our new name. Yeah, thank you very much. So every time when I say ICTR, I have to put a dollar in the jar, so
yeah.
Let's go EUC.
I'm already $5 up front to Ryan.
Yeah. Okay, so go EUC.
$6 up front.
Now, we want to be on top of the community with all the experts. So this is us. But if you ask our colleagues, they always think that we are actually on the beach drinking cocktails because we're always away. But in reality, it's more like this because we're traveling a lot, so we're sipping cocktails within the plane. But to be honest, I don't like cocktails. I'm a beer guy. I love IPAs.
And I'm more like before stouts.
But running this kind of community, it takes a lot of effort. So we're quite often very exhausted with all of the writing and the testing because we do this besides our current job. We're not doing it alone. It's luckily a team effort. So it's really community driven. Multiple people are involved, and these are the current members right now. And we want to expand. So if you're really interested, you can always come up and join us. We do this kind of research because it's important to gain this knowledge. And it's interesting for us, but also for you all, as you can implement it at your own environment or at your customers. We share all the information at our platform. And this is still the old one. We're going to rebrand it.
Is that going to cost you a dollar again, Ryan? Or
sorry?
Is that going to cost you a dollar because it doesn't say go
no,
EUC?
No. It's not worked that way.
Fair enough.
But we publish everything in a blog format. It's easy to read, easy to follow, and it's totally free. But in order to do this kind of research, you need some hardware. We currently have two infrastructure hosts, or two specific hosts. We got an infrastructure one, which is represented on the left side, and it's a smaller one. And we got our testing hosts, and this is where the workload really gonna run, and it's a bigger server, of course. As the name's described, in the infrastructure part, we run all the different components of the infrastructure, including the login VSR our launchers. And the testing host is pretty dedicated for the workload itself, so there's no other component running there. Everything we test, we currently use login VSR. So how many of you already know login VSR? It's quite a few.
Again, more than five, very good to know.
Yeah. Login VSR is the industry benchmarking solution for testing these kinds of environments, so the VDI environments. If you want to know more, they are here at Synergy. I think they got a stand. I don't know the number, but you can collect some information over there. But if you look at our testing automation, it's not just a single test that we run and publish the results. Each single scenario that we test, we run 10 times. And to give you a little bit of idea, completing this cycle 10 times takes around 24 hours. And it's generating a lot of data that we need to process. So everything we publish and also present here, those are averages of the 10 runs. So we really do the thorough research for these kinds of information. But we're not only using the login VSI data, we collect the data from multiple levels. So we also collect the data from the hypervisor itself. So in this case, we're running VMware. So we're collecting the ESX top. We're collecting the launcher data. So the launchers are a VSI component, which represents the endpoint. So we also get a perspective from that. And we're using protocol data, and therefore we're using remote display analyzer. So this also allows us to give a complete picture of what's the impact of everything. So today we have a couple interesting topics for you. So let's start with the first one, Citrix Cloud.
Let's dive right in. Citrix Cloud. According to a recent study, more than 20% of the people are considering or are using Citrix Cloud at the moment in their daily business. Can I have a show of hands who is using Citrix Cloud at the moment in their daily work? Oh, it's pretty much. As a consultant, one of the most asked questions I get about Citrix Cloud is about performance. Citrix has done a tremendous amount of work with Citrix Tech Zone on documenting Citrix Cloud, but the part we thought was missing was a research or topic after what that using Citrix Cloud meant for the scalability and the performance of your systems. So for those of you who aren't familiar with Citrix Cloud Services, I can hardly imagine, but we never know. Citrix Cloud Services simplifies the delivery and management of Citrix technologies, helping you to extend your on-premise software deployments or move 100% to the cloud. So when you sign up for Citrix Cloud, one of the first things you have to think about is the choice of regions. As it stands as of now, Citrix Cloud is available in three regions. We got the United States, we got the European Union, and we got Asian South Pacific. So when you choose a region, be very careful for this, because you cannot change it that easily. Well, best tip first, always choose a region that is closest to the majority of your users. So for this research, the infrastructure is a little bit different from the one that Ryan just showed you. Instead of delivery controllers, we added two cloud connectors. And we use the cloud connectors to connect our lab up to the Citrix Cloud Management Plane. We kept the storefront online, we kept the storefront in our data center because we just wanted to test the impact of the brokering on the performance. On the testing host on the right, we didn't change anything. The only thing we did is point the VDAs towards the cloud connector instead of the delivery controllers. Something good to mention now is that Ryan hasn't mentioned, our data center is located in Germany. So for us, the Citrix Cloud region for the European Union would be the most obvious choice. So if we look at the test scenario, we got the default scenario here set up. All our VDAs are configured with two vCPUs and 4 GB of memory. We're using Windows 10 1803, and we're using a recent VDA version. In this case, it's 1808. Again, remember, we kept the on-premise storefront. So for the tests, we got three scenarios. First up in blue is our baseline. That's a traditional on-premise environment, no cloud involved. For the second one, in orange, we got the Citrix Cloud. And for this, we selected the United States as the region. And lastly, in gray, we got Citrix Cloud where we selected the European Union when we signed up. So if we look at the data, the first metric we use is the VSI Max. And the VSI Max is a representation, difficult word, of our server scalability. And if we look at the data, we can see that there's virtually no change in server scalability. If we look at the host CPU usage, we can see that this reflected again. There's almost no change. There's only 1% increase in host CPU utilization.
And this also makes sense, right? Because everything is still running within the data center. Only the brokering part is going through the cloud.
If we look at it from an endpoint standpoint, we can see again that there's only a minimal change in CPU usage. We only see a 6% increase when we connect up our VDAs that are in the German data center to the Citrix Cloud environment with the brokering done in the US. If we look at the login times in seconds, we can see a change. When we start with our on-premise scenario, we got a 44-second login time. But when we switch to either of the cloud environments, we can see that there's a slight increase in logon times, 6 or 7 seconds. If we put it into percentages, we get a 16 and a 12% increase in logon times. So this all has to do with latency. In our on-premise environment, and in yours too, all components are located in the same LAN. So there's virtually no latency. And I hope they're all connected via high-speed networks. When you introduce any cloud, you get latency. And this will amount in a higher logon time for your users. So in summary, using Citrix Cloud, there is virtually no impact for the brokering from a capacity standpoint. If you look at an endpoint perspective, there's no real performance penalty either. But be aware, when you use Citrix Cloud for the brokering, there is a penalty, and the penalty is the logon times. Lastly, again, always choose the region that is closest to where the majority of your users are. And make that choice very good, because you cannot change it that easily.
Awesome.
Here you go, Ryan.
Let's go to the next topic, the visual quality. How many of you are playing around with the visual quality within your environment? So quite a few. So for those who don't know what the visual quality policy is, it's the component that will influence the quality that sends over from your VDI or your central desktop towards the endpoint. And there are multiple options here. So by default, we have the medium, which is representing just what it sets as a medium quality. You have the low one and the high. But you also have the always lossless and the build to lossless. So the always lossless, that represents the best quality sending over. So it will ensure that it's always the best quality it can get. It won't degrade down. With the build-to-lossless, it's the same, but if there are constraints, it will lower the quality. So for this test scenario, we again take a default configuration. So we use a recent Windows 10 build, again with the same configuration of the vCPUs and memory. Again, a recent VDA. Of course, as breakfasters, everything is optimized. And it's important to understand, by default, TCP is used. And we also applied a small modification to login VSI, but I will explain that later. So we comparing the scenarios, and in blue, we're using the medium, as that is the default when you don't configure anything. And in the other scenarios are represented. There's a small change here. In the yellow one, we're using the visual quality high using EDT. So it's the UDP protocol. So for the VSI modifications, for this research, we want to ensure that nothing is really influencing the results, so also from the frame per second perspective. So we decided to remove the progress bar completely. Please note, this is not a best practice. So if you do real research as using login VSI, you shouldn't remove the progress bar. however we did it. Looking from a capacity perspective, we can see a slight change. So for the medium, low, high, and the high using EDT, we see no change, or a slight change. This is different you showing, or for the scenarios, the always lossless and the built to lossless. And this is also, or not reflected within the VSI baseline. So the baseline is the measurements of VSI, how snappy the session itself is. But there's one important note here. Every measurement is within the session itself, so it's not taking the protocol into account. Looking at the utilization, we again see the similar trend as the VSI max. So there is an increase using the always losses and built to losses. And this makes sense, right? It costs more resources to process the higher quality towards the endpoints. Now, processing the image quality, it doesn't require any storage. So when looking at the storage perspective, we don't see any change within the reads and writes. And that makes sense. Now, looking at the frames per second. So these are the frames that sent over by the protocol. And this is measured with remote display analyzer. So we see here some changes. And what you really can see that the built to lossless is really successful with sending over all the frames towards the endpoint, because it can adapt towards the lower quality. But looking at the CPU for encoding, it really requires more processing power to encode all the image and the quality. So it's important to take at least that in account. So this is only the process for encoding itself. So it's not the CPU utilization within the session. But there is a note. You can lower the CPU impact using GPU technology for offloading this. However, we didn't test it yet.
Yet.
It's an interesting one for us to research. So looking at round-trip times, which is the latency towards the session itself, we again can see here the similar trend for the always losses and built to lossless. It requires more resources, so it takes, there's more delay within the session. And also the bandwidth, we see a lot of differences here. And this makes sense, right? The lower the quality, the lower the bandwidth is required. The higher the quality, the higher it is. And this is really an important one. So this is the endpoint CPU utilization. And to be honest, I was quite surprised seeing the high impact when using built to lossless. So in case if you have thin clients that are low on resources, you really need to take this in account, or otherwise your users can still have or experience a crappy user experience towards the session. So this is really an important one. So let's wrap this one up. You have the visual qualities for different use cases. It's up to you guys to pick the appropriate one. We do see a small difference in the scalability from a server perspective, especially when using the always lossless and built to lossless. But the important one here is that it requires resources sending over the different qualities over the protocol itself. So you need to take that in account, and especially the endpoints. Let's go to the next topic.
Yeah, next up. Scalability templates, Citrix policy templates. This research actually came about when I had a customer come up to me a couple of months back, and they were complaining that they had a very low server scalability on the systems. That meant that they weren't getting the amount of users on their boxes they expected to. So we dug into the problem, we did some research, and we discovered that they had a consultant over a couple of weeks back, and he was fiddling around with the policy templates. And he had inadvertently applied the very high user definition policy template to the system. That meant that their users were getting a very high user experience, but the cost was that they had a very low server scalability. So what actually is a Citrix policy template? Well, Citrix delivers a built-in policy template that you can use as a starting point for setting up your policies in the Citrix Filter Apps and Desktops environment. And they come for all kinds of use cases, as you can see here. You have one for server scalability, you have them for optimized for WAN, security control, or the one I just mentioned, the very high user definition experience template. So we wanted to test that. We wanted to test what the impact was of using either of these templates. And we picked the two most used templates. So the very high user definition experience in orange, and in gray, the high server scalability. We compared them to our baseline in blue, and it's just a vanilla installation. So we didn't set any policies, and we didn't apply any templates. For our VDAs, we kept our standard configuration, so 2 vCPUs, 4 gigabytes of memory, Windows 10 1809, and we used a recent VDA version, 1811 in this case. We optimized the image with Citrix Optimizer using the 1809 template, and we applied the login VSI modification on the progress bar. Just like Ryan said, don't do this at home. It's not best practice. But for us, this will create the level playing field for testing our environment. So again, the first one we have is our server scalability. And if we look at the server scalability, in orange, the high server scalability template does exactly what the name says. It is increasing our server scalability by 10% at least. If we look in gray at our very high user definition experience template, we see a decrease in VSI max of around 16%. And again, also this makes sense. And we're delivering our users for the best experience possible, but it comes at a cost. Again, when we look at the host CPU utilization, this high server scalability template will lower the CPU usage on your host by 10%. But switching to a high user definition, that'll come with a penalty. And the penalty here is almost a 10% increase in CPU utilization. So frames per second, and this is an interesting one. Generally speaking, a higher frame per second count will amount in a smoother user experience for your users. So what's happening here? Well, this all has to do with the video codec that's being used. If you use a standard out-of-the-box installation and you don't set any policies, the video codec will automatically be set to use when preferred. And that means that the system will dynamically decide where and why and how to use a video codec. When we switch to the high server scalability and we apply that template, we are not using any video encodec. We're just using still image compression and bitmap caching. For the very high user definition, on the other hand, we're always using the video codec for the entire screen. So that means we're always encoding the entire screen and sending it over to the client. And we can see what's happening here. When we need to encode the entire screen every time, the CPU for encoding goes to the roof. We can see 170% increase in the time that the host CPU is busy encoding the stream to send to the client. And we can see a massive drop in CPU for encoding when we use the high server scalability template. Of course, that's logical because we're not using any video encoding. If we look at the round trip time, we can see that the high server scalability does come in a penalty for the round trip time. But the very high user definition is almost on par with the default settings that we used. Bandwidth usage. If we use the high server scalability because we don't need to send the encoded video stream over to the client and we use bitmap caching a lot, it will require a lot less bandwidth than the other two protocols. The funny thing I saw was that the very high user definition template, so the template you use to get the highest possible user experience to your client, is using 20% less bandwidth than the default scenario. Here we come to the bread and butter of it all. Because if you use the very high user definition template to get the best user experience to your client, again, we are encoding the entire screen every time to the client. And then the client endpoint, we always need to decode that entire screen. And that comes with a penalty of almost 43% increase in endpoint CPU utilization. So if you are using endpoints that are resource constrained, for example, thin clients, older PCs, or mobile devices, please take care of this. Keep this in mind. So to summarize it all, we can see a decrease in service scalability if you want to use the best possible user experience for your user and are using the very high definition user experience template. Besides an impact on the server side, we can also see a massive impact on the client side. So it all comes down actually, what is more important for you or your customer? Do you want to maximize server scalability, or do you want to provide your users with the best possible user experience? Talking about scalability and experience, Ryan?
Yeah, let's go to the next topic, which is the Citrix Optimizer. How many of you already seen the session of Martin? Quite a few. And how many of you are already using the Optimizer?
Huh. Awesome.
You better should be. So for those who don't know what the Optimizer is, it's a tool provided by Citrix, and actually Martin Zugec is the owner of it, which allows you to optimize your windows. So the tool provides you templates for the different Windows versions with different categories to optimize. So if you want to know more, I know that Martin is doing another session later today. I highly recommend to go to that session. He will explain a lot more about the optimizer itself. So let's go to the testing results. So in this case, again, we're using a default configuration. And for the testing scenarios, we're comparing everything to a not optimized machine, which is represented in the blue.
Yeah, one small side note, we would not recommend using the blue scenario in your own environment.
Correct. So what we have done is, for the other scenarios represented in orange one, is selecting all the available options within the analyzer with the appropriate template. So represented in the gray, we're only using the disabled services group, yellow only the built-in apps, which are the universal apps within Windows, the tasks, and the other options represented in the green. So looking at the VSR max, the overall capacity, it makes sense, right? Optimizing your image helps increasing the capacity of your environment. We all know this. This is a common best practice. But the interesting here is that the majority of the improvement is only from the built-in apps. And that was an interesting finding. So looking at the baseline itself, we don't see a lot of changes. Of course, the fully optimized, we see an increase or an improvement in the baseline responsiveness. But it's not really, it's not a lot. So looking from the CPU utilization, it makes sense. It's reflecting the VSR max. Again, using all the optimizations has the best improvement in the lowering the CPU utilization, which is again caused by the built-in apps. But also from a storage perspective. So important thing here to know is that when your user is logging on for the first time, the built-in app will provision the application within your profile. And this is really causing a lot of reads and writes. So when removing the built-in apps, you really see it also from a storage perspective. Not only the reads, also in the writes. So when you have storage issues, make sure to remove the built-in apps that are not used. Maybe you need to leave Calculator in there. It's an annoying one. But optimizing your Windows version helps a lot with the login times. And as you can see here, it's quite a lot. Again, here also, the trend continues. It's all about the built-in apps. And moving that to a percentage, it's quite a lot, it's almost 25%, only for the built-in apps. So let's summarize this one. It's a best practice. You should optimize your image. However, if you don't do it, it's reflected in your scalability of your environment, but also in the user experience, of course. Removing the built-in apps is the key optimization here. However, it doesn't apply to a server operating system. Besides, we don't see real improvement when only disabling the services and the task. We still recommend to remove those that are not used. So it's still best practice. So let's move to the next one.
Yes, one of my favorite topics here, different VDA versions. LTSR versus current release. It's an everlasting debate. It's one of the most debates I hear when I work with my customers. Do I stay on LTSR or do I move to a current release version? How many of you are using a current release version at the moment? An LTSR? The majority of you are still on LTSR. And why is that? If you stay on LTSR, you buy predictability. You get 5 years of regular support. But you are missing out. You are missing out on the latest of features and improvements that Citrix has to offer. I made up a small list of features that have been added to the VDA since 7.15. This is by no means a complete list. It's just a few of the most noteworthy I think they added. Yeah, everybody's pictures done? You can also find these up on the Citrix site. So we thought up of a test scenario. When we talk about the configuration, again, it's the same as all the other configurations. We're using two vCPUs, 4 GB of memory. We got Windows 10, 1809. We got an optimized image. Again, Ryan just explained, always optimize your image. And I always listen to Ryan, so we optimized all the images. And we did apply the Logman VSI modification to the progress bar. Again, disclaimer, don't do this at home. For our baseline, up on top of the right corner in the dark blue, we got 7.15 cumulative update 3. At the time we ran this scenario, CU3 was the latest version. Up now, we got the latest version in CU4, but we didn't have time to test that yet. And we compared 7.15 to 4 CR versions. In orange, we got 7.18. In gray, we got 18.08. In yellow, 18.11. And in light blue, we got the latest current release, which is 19.03. So, again, first up, server scalability. And here we can see that starting from 18.08, we can see massive improvement in overall server scalability when you switch from LTSR to a CR version. If you look at the data, you can see that you can easily gain 25% more users on your system when you switch from LTSR to 19.03. If you look at the host CPU utilization, we can see the same trend. We can see a massive decrease in host CPU utilization when we compare a VDA from 7.15 to the 19.03 version. When we look at the reads, again, there's a decrease in overall read capacity needed. We do have to add a small disclaimer for this one. The 1811 and 1903, the decrease in host reads per second, we probably cannot contribute that to the VDA version completely, because we can see that in our lab in other scenarios as well. This is more what we expected for the host reads. If we look at the logon times, this is really where we can see the current release start to shine. When we start with our baseline, so the LTSR version, we're up on 61 seconds of login time. And when we switch to either of the current release versions, you can see a massive drop in logon times that are consistent over the whole range. If we put that into percentages, we can see 15 to 25% decrease in login time for your users when you provide it with the CR version of the VDA instead of an LTSR version. Quite impressive, right?
No.
Thank you, Ryan. If you look at the frames per second, here we can see that in the newer version, Citrix have worked very hard in the protocol to get it as efficient as possible. Again, CPU for encoding is massively dropping. And when we look at the round trip time, so the snappiness of the session for your user, awesome decrease in round trip time. 60% almost when you compare 7.15 to 19.03. This will make your users very happy. Again, also with the bandwidth usage, the story is almost getting boring. It's getting better and better. So, to sum this up, we recommend to stay on the current release to benefit from the latest and greatest features and get the best improvements you get. But you have to be prepared for the 6-month release cycle that CR has, similar as in Windows 10. The current release has a big, big improvement on the performance and overall scalability. As a small side note, if you're using Citrix Cloud, you can use either LTSR or CR for your scenarios. Not for your workload, sorry. So, we're gonna give you the key takeaways. Starting with the first one, Citrix Cloud. Always choose your Citrix Cloud region wisely. You cannot change it. And always choose a region, I said it before, where the majority of your users are located.
Yeah, so for the visual quality, ensure it will have an effect on the metrics itself, and especially your endpoint. So if you have an endpoint that is lower on the resources, ensure to validate and test it.
Scalability templates. It all boils down to the choice you have for you and your customer. Do you need to maximize scalability, or do you want to have your users get the best user experience? From Citrix, the best practice and the recommended practice is if you are using a VDA 7.18 or later, and you do not need to deliver 3D or CAD workloads, don't apply a template and leave everything to the default and let the system decide.
So for the optimizer, we all know it's a best practice, but the key takeaway here is removing the built-in apps within Windows 10. Those have the, the main effect of the optimizations.
Yeah, and for the VDA versions, probably still fresh in your memory, we recommend always use the current release if you can. You get the latest and greatest in terms of features, scalability, and performance, but be prepared for the 6-month release schedule.
Just like Windows 10.
Just like Windows 10, exactly.
So we are doing these kinds of researches, and it's a community thing. So feel free to contribute to our platform. We got a QR code, which is linking towards our Slack channel. Get involved and start interacting with us. It's sometimes really fun to just geek out and have nerd conversations. But also share your ideas. We're always open for ideas and interesting researches. We got a massive backlog, so we have to discuss and prioritize, but any idea is a great idea. But you can also be more involved by start writing yourself. And we are really open for members, and it can be ending up like here, presenting the content that you produced.
So if you want to be on Synergy 2020,
come start for
GoEUC.
Check. But I think the key takeaway here is that you have to validate it. You cannot just assume all the best practices that will have a positive effect within your environment. So make sure you test yourself and you have the data to prove your organization that you have to apply these changes. Data really helps with these kinds of researches. So here's an ugly slide from Citrix.
Yeah.
Sorry, Citrix. It's a recommended session. We really recommend going to the optimizer one from Martin.
And if you want to know more about the HDIC protocol and what the Citrix is doing in the protocol level, join Citrix session SIN 211.
Yeah. Of course, rate our session. Feedback always helps. And we want to thank you all for attending.